We didn't always fish for gar. In fact, as we pedaled our bikes down the shell road to the canals, we talked about our favorite catch, turtles. Richard already had a small soft shell and a snapper, which he kept in an old vegetable crisper in his backyard. And we both released, at our parents' insistence, all of the bigger, readier turtles that we tried to keep inside my folks' chain link fence. But only when they began to bulldoze through the St. Augustine like a herd of little buffalo. This time, as we eased up to the bank, we didn't see a single turtle, so we left our bikes there where the road crossed the canal. Richard led the way to the point, our spot, where the two canals formed a T and where a huge water oak had fallen into the water. I knew we wouldn't catch any turtles when Richard said, "Looks like we go after old Iron Jaw today. In a little while, there'll be so many bugs and mosquitoes on the water, he'll have to come up to us." Though I didn't care to stand in the dusk with all of the mosquitoes in Louisiana buzzing me, I knew Richard was right about how gar react. Yet I couldn't help but tease him about this giant gar. "The way you talk, you're the only Iron Jaw around here." Richard couldn't have asked for a better invitation. "Just wait. One day, maybe today, when you walk out on this tree, you're going to slip. Maybe just your foot will go in before you get your balance, but that'll be enough for a good snack for old Iron Jaw." After fishing a short while on bottom for catfish, and really for any turtles that may have been cruising by unseen, Richard reeled in and snapped a cork on just above his hook full of soggy worms. I did the same without saying a word, because I knew he had seen the first gar of the afternoon. We began tossing our lines as close as possible to the tree limbs and then jerking the corks so the gar would investigate. Slowly but steadily, they rose through the branches. Once or twice when I turned from the water to see the sunset, I couldn't tell right away when I looked at my cork whether the mottled shapes near it were limbs or gar. In a few minutes, the difference would no longer matter. Gar would be everywhere. As usual, Richard was first to get one to nibble. The fish worked the end of his snout like pliers that kept slipping off of the bolt. In this case, every snip meant he had that much less bait. "That's not Iron Jaw," I said. "Oh, he won't be along till later, till after there's a whole cloud of mosquitoes over the water and all the baby gar have fed. Besides, any gar you see won't be Iron Jaw." "You mean he knows we're up here and won't show himself?" I asked, as we watched the little gar make his cork bobble. "No, I mean he won't ever bite when you watch. He only bites when you're not looking." Before I could respond to that amazing bit of news, I noticed that a fair-sized gar had appeared a foot away from my cork. I bumped the line to try to help it find the bait. On more than one occasion, they swam up to the cork and nipped at it. Richard would sometimes jerk his rod hard when they did that. He aimed to snag them in the side, if they were, as he said, too stupid to tell a plug of plastic from a gob of God's own worms. Neither of us ever caught a gar that way, but then we rarely ever landed one when they took the bait. Our fathers refused our every plea for good, solid, 10-pound test line. The line that came with our reels, and there never seemed an end to it, was good enough for us, they explained. And that was that. But that never stopped us from fishing for gar. It was simply too strange and too exciting to see them materialize, as if from thin air, or as if that tree's branches had snapped off underwater and would turn into gar just for us, if not for Richard alone, who plainly never had a problem with believing in things he couldn't see. Richard sat his reel on the ground and walked over to my spot by the kicked-up roots of the oak as my gar slowly sank through the pale green water. "Look, you scared it off," I complained. "He'd have popped your little line anyway," he said as he turned to go back. I was about to boast that that's the only way it would have gotten off of my line once I hooked it, when Richard screamed out that name, "Iron Jaw!" His cork was not only gone from sight, but his slack line sliced into the water and his rod began to skitter down the bank. He snatched it up as the last eyelet of the rod hit the water. Richard heaved the reel straight over his head, and his line did not snap, which was much a surprise to me as it was to Richard, and he was in the middle of a religious experience, shouting that name again, and then, "I've got him this time." With that, the line went slack and the cork bobbled up deep in the tangle of branches. "Did you see? Did you see? You should have felt it. Talk about strong. I thought he was going to pull me in. I told you, that's where he lives, right there in the thickest part of that treetop." There could be no argument now, and after Richard walked onto the tree to work his line free, he raised only the shank of a hook. No foot of his was going to slip in that water as he made his way carefully but triumphantly back to dangle that shiny piece of evidence before my eyes. I could think of all kinds of reasons for why things happened as they did, none of which hinged upon an inscrutable, all-powerful garfish. But it never seemed quite right to doubt Richard all the way down the line. There was something uncanny about the way everything backed up his stories. He needed just a little goading in the form of my tentative doubts to make him divine the true shape that fit all of the circumstances. And after that afternoon by the gar tree, old Ironjaw became a force that would never go out of Richard's world. Several weeks later, something happened that made me take his story with more than just a pinch of politeness. It was a hot Saturday in June, so Richard and I were on our bikes and headed for the canals just as soon as our mothers released us from letting lunch digest. When we dismounted at the first canal, a short walk from the downed water oak, Richard said, "Let's fish from the culverts here. We can try both sides of the road and save the point for later." "You mean save Ironjaw for later," I teased. "You better believe it." There was no shade on the 10 culverts, and we only dared sit on them after our shadows lay over them for quite some time. By then, the sun and the fact that nothing was stirring or biting had sapped our enthusiasm and strength. But neither of us realized that our energies had drained like so much of our sweat. Richard began to fiddle around when the tiniest imaginable pumpkin seed nibbled at his bait almost directly below his feet. It would bite just to the left of the culvert opening. For a few moments the fish made his cork jig like the only thing in the world with any life to it, but it was too small to get on the hook. Finally, the sun seemed to reach down to quiet even that overgrown minnow. Then we noticed something about the canals that we never would have guessed. The water moved. Once the pumpkin seed stopped interfering, the canal pulled Richard's cork slowly past the culvert lip and down through the tin under our feet. We had watched the waters fill up with algae and water lilies every summer and never realized that the canal slid by the banks like fat slugs. We looked at each other. Perhaps nothing else in the entire world was stirring, but when that pipe swallowed his cork, something like a fresh breeze played over the hairs on the back of our necks. In an instant, we lay on the tin and peered in at his cork as it lazily followed the steady but painfully slow current. It took more than an instant for what happened next to sink in. The cork disappeared. Maybe the heat had addled our brains. Maybe our eyes and the shade inside the culvert were playing tricks on us. Whatever the reason, we lay there on the ribbed pipe as if asleep until Richard's rod, which was halfway beneath him, jerked us awake. Richard moved with unearthly speed. Before I could quite get up, he was on his feet, cranking the reel while the rod tip pointed into the mouth of the culvert like a water witch's dowser. He looked like a man on a deep-sea fishing show, pulling the rod up high and then cranking the line furiously while dropping the tip to pull again. He looked as if he were about to draw swordfish from a secret hole deep beneath the canal, as if he were about to make it leap from the culvert into broad daylight. A violent splash right under our feet sent spray flying out of the pipe. The rod tip shot down and just as suddenly shot back up. The fish was gone, and everything was just as still as before. Richard and I looked at each other again, not in disbelief, but as if stunned. The sun still poured down on the shell road, the canal, the culvert, and us, but it had no more power over Richard and me. It was as if we had suddenly entered a shady pocket within the glare of the steadily streaming sun. Richard said, "There's gar in this pipe." When we lowered ourselves onto the culvert again, we bowed our heads before the opening, slowly, with the gravity and fear of reverence. The ribbed walls gathered and reflected enough light at both ends to make the surface visible throughout, but the roof of the culvert also sent its reflected image onto the surface. So at times I felt as if I were peering at culvert walls and nothing else. If you weren't careful, a trick of the eye made the surface disappear, and you saw only an empty culvert. It was dizzying. At least it was to me. Richard only said, "Let's rig our corpse above our hooks and send them both in." The snail's pace race was on. We let out line, laid down again on the thin tin pipe, and watched the slow motion waverings of the corpse as they rode the current's casual meanderings. It seemed that they would never get back to the point where Richard's cork had vanished. "Did you see that?" "No," I said. "The water stirred about 3 feet past the corpse. I thought I saw a fin." "I didn't see anything, and nothing bothered the corpse except their pattern of slow, advancing curves through the pipe. It was a chore to see the right thing. Though the surface, the corpse, and the reflection were all there was to see, I couldn't clearly watch both the corpse and the surrounding surface. The reflection became a trapdoor that repeatedly swallowed my attention. I had to fight to shake the illusion that there was only an empty culvert before me. And soon enough, I had to fight to avoid the feeling that I was drifting down through the ribbed walls. Talk was the best help. "Richard, do you suppose the gar from the tree come in here when it gets hot like today?" My question rang on the walls as if some other voice asked it. "It's not big enough," he said. "All of those fish couldn't ever fit in here, even if the whole pipe was full of water instead of just halfway." "Could Iron Jaw fit?" "Yes," he answered, without hesitation. My mistake then was that I didn't immediately ask how a gar the size of Iron Jaw could possibly fit inside, since Richard always made him sound like he would be at least as big as the culvert. My doubts about Richard's view of things had once been as big as that, but they had shrunk or been compromised by enough circumstances to keep me lying on the culvert, content that Richard's fish could be in there, a few feet in front of my face. I said nothing more, and neither did Richard. Our corks neared the other end of the pipe, but nothing had bothered them, so we reeled them to our end and started over. They began another trip, dithering right before our eyes, right between our eyes. Our reflections joined in the watch at the mouth of the culvert. Iron Jaw or no Iron Jaw, it was harder than before to concentrate on the corks and the surface. The reflection of the curved roof appeared to curve downward. The only change was our reflection. I no longer simply felt the slight falling sensation. I saw myself falling through the great ribs. The world I knew was gone. The slow streams of the sun, the slower stream to the canal, had vanished. The only moving thing was the belly of endless ribs as it surged by me. I heard a voice say, "There's nothing in here." I knew that was true, but I couldn't tell who said it or why. After a long pause, someone said, "Let's go to the point." And I knew it was Richard. There were our corks entering the sunlight at the far end of the pipe. I said, "Yes, that's where Iron Jaw will be waiting for us." "Better believe it."